The Japanese cities of Hiroshima and Nagasaki were attacked with atomic bombs on the 6th and 9th of August 1945. 70 years later, 40 governments still rely on nuclear weapons. 9 states possess nuclear arsenals, and 31 other states, including Australia, are willing to have the United States use nuclear weapons on their behalf. Anniversaries give us the chance to pause, to listen to the survivors, and to join in prayer for peace on earth, to say unequivocally, never again. Hiroshima and Auschwitz have been described as the two Holocausts of the 20th century world. The terrible events of Auschwitz and the other concentration camps were wrought by our enemies, whereas the disasters in Japan were brought about by the Allies. The experience of the concentration camps was soon spoken of and published, but for the victims of the atomic bombs, there was hardly any opportunity to communicate their experiences to the public. I remember the first time I thought much about Hiroshima. I was 12. I read a poem in a school textbook. My generation was not one that was taught to memorize poetry like my parents' generation, but I boldly decided that I would commit that tiny 26-word anonymous poem to memory. Noon and hazy heat, a single silver sliver and a dull drone, a gloved finger poised and pressed, a second silence and then oblivion. It is about the nuclear bombing, seen and felt from a distance. Yet it was probably the first time I felt deeply the enormity of what had happened, and for the first time it dawned on me that the devastation in Hiroshima and Nagasaki was caused by individual human agents. The gloved finger of the fighter pilot, poised, pressed. It was a realization about the capacity of human beings, even the ones who were on our side, that the capacity that we have for causing horror, devastation, and evil. I've been exposed to much more literature about the Jewish Holocaust than the Japanese. One source for expanding my knowledge of the Japanese experience was a Christian Conference of Asia liturgy book, which included a reflection by Japanese poet Kurihara Sadako. She told of American censorship of the experience of the bombs. Her own work, written in the 40s, wasn't published until the 80s. Writing in a world that still had the capacity to destroy itself many times over with its nuclear arsenals, Sadako's own poetry was written to end the atomic age. Included in the reflection that I read was a story poem entitled, "We Shall Bring Forth New Life." She wrote, "It was a night spent in the basement of a burnt-out building. People injured by the atomic bomb took shelter in this room, filling it. They passed the night in darkness, not even a single candle among them. The raw smell of blood, the stench of death, body heat and the reek of sweat, moaning. Miraculously, out of the darkness, a voice sounded, 'The baby's coming.' In that basement room, in those lower reaches of hell, a young woman was going into labor. What were they to do? without even a single match to light the darkness. People forgot their own suffering to do what they could. A seriously injured woman who had been moaning but a moment before spoke out, "I am a midwife. Let me help with the birth." And now life was born, there in the deep, dark depths of hell. Her work done, the midwife did not even wait for the break of day. She died, still covered with the blood. Bring forth new life, even if it should cost my own. Bring forth new life. The story poem was based on a real event. It happened at the end of a 15-year expansionist war waged by Japanese imperialism in Asia. The blood-covered midwife who died before she could see the dawn was one of the 200,000 people killed by that bomb. She died without experiencing the first day of peace, August 15th. Sadako questioned what new life meant in that context and concluded that it was the birth of a new Hiroshima, a Hiroshima that would not cease to long for peace in the world. Sadako wrote poetry and prose so that we might create a world of peace without atomic weapons or war. On this Peace Sunday, 70 years later, the peace we now live seems fragile. We live in a world shaped by the violence and the cycle of retaliation that followed the events of September 11th, 2001. And on this Peace Sunday, as important it is to remember Hiroshima and Nagasaki, as important it is to continue to oppose the proliferation of nuclear weapons, we also need to attend to peace in its widest dimensions. Without justice, there will never be peace. Wherever in the world there is poverty, there is also tension and conflict. Wherever there is fighting and war, there is also poverty. We often interpret peace simplistically as meaning the absence of war. But peace in the biblical sense of shalom is much more than this. Peace encompasses the presence of justice and integrity, where all people and all creatures can share in the goodness of creation. Peace requires the denunciation of racism, xenophobia, and homophobia. No justice, no peace. Peace is one of the great themes of faith. Yet often we practitioners of religion lose sight of the great themes and focus on small and insignificant details and practices. We maintain traditions that at one point may have given life, but the meaning of them has long since been lost. In Jesus' encounter with the Pharisees and scribes in the reading from Mark, we are reminded to return to the essence of relationship with the sacred, to the God who calls us to be peacemakers and justice seekers. When Jesus says, "You abandon the commandment of God and hold on to human tradition," it's easy to imagine that it doesn't apply to us. We're progressive, after all. But this story names the struggle that every community in every age faces, including our own. How can the tradition of the elders, which has given us our identity, now be changed so that what was good in it, the desire to live in harmony with God, could actually be expressed in our current circumstances? If we want to examine the heart of religious faith, we must be willing to explore honestly whether our own attitudes and actions reveal genuine love for God, the sacred, and whether they reveal compassion for others, for these two go together. Jesus' words remind us that the growth of our capacity to love is directly related to an increased awareness of the hidden intentions of our hearts. Jesus criticizes empty practices, but that doesn't mean that our faith is not enriched and strengthened by practices. The question is, which practices? Do we do certain things in our personal lives or in our church traditions that no longer give life or make for peace? We are invited, each one of us, to look at the ways that our daily habits, religious or otherwise, encourage our awareness of God and impact on our relationships with our loved ones and with strangers. It's easy to reduce Christianity to a set of values or even a set of traditions or practices. The call here, though, is to return again and again to God, the sacred source of love and justice and peace, to return to God in search of transformation, to love passionately and peacefully until all the earth experiences the hope of a new day, a time when we may say not just about our personal relationships but about our planetary relationships. For now the winter is past, the rain is over and gone, the flowers appear on the earth, the time of singing has come, and the voice of the turtle dove is heard in our land. The fig tree puts forth its figs, and vines are in blossom. They give forth fragrance, a fragrance of peace. However difficult or challenging Jesus' words may be, there is within them the hope of renewing our attitudes and actions, so that we may reflect God's loving purpose for humanity and for all creation. Nothing less than a vision of love and justice and peace. In faith, we claim that we are held in God's holy embrace. In faith, we claim that our world can be different because trust in the God made known to us in Jesus can transform us and our world.